Church family, we're so excited that you're here today. Please stand and sing the song.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all. Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. To order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Yeah, this is amazing grace. Unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Everybody, I invite you to greet your neighbor with the love of Christ this morning.
As you make your way back to your seats, if you would remain standing as you're able so that we could affirm our faith together using the words of the Apostles' Creed as our guide, would you join with me? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Well, good morning, church. What a gift it is to be able to gather together to worship the Lord God Almighty this morning. I want to welcome you all to worship. I want to offer a special welcome to those of you who are guests with us this morning. It's an honor that you would choose to spend your Sunday morning here with us, worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ. In the seat backs in front of you, you could see that there's an I'm New card. We would love to connect with you to begin on this journey of faith alongside of you. And so if you would fill out some contact information there, you could put it in the chest on your way out after worship. Would love to connect with you in that way. We have a beautiful opportunity every Sunday. It's an opportunity to be generous. But we think of it this way. We get to give. We have the opportunity to give. And it's out of the abundance and thanksgiving that we have for all that the Lord has done in us and through us in our lives. And so when we think about it this way, that the Lord has blessed us, and then we get the opportunity to bless others with those resources, and then we get to see the blessing in their lives over the course of time. So I'm going to invite the ushers to come forward for this morning's offering, but first I'm going to say a prayer of blessing over this offering. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for all of the ways that you have blessed us in our lives. Lord, the ways in which you have restored us and strengthened us and renewed us and given us capacity to serve your world. Lord, we ask your blessing upon these gifts and these givers alike, that all that is done through the generosity of the saints would be for your glory, honor, and praise. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. The ushers are going to come forward. I have one more just a card in the seat back in front of you. There's a prayer card. We would love to come alongside you in prayer. We know that each and every one of you has come in this morning with a different set of circumstances in your life, that you have things going on in your family, in your homes, in your neighborhoods, in your workplaces, and we want to come alongside you in prayer. So whatever the prayer is on your heart this day, I hope that you will take the time and fill out that prayer card. We have a prayer team that's ready to pray with you. We have pastors and our staff. All of the prayer requests that are given will be lifted up multiple times each week. So I hope that you'll fill that out as well. Just three invitations for you. The first is a special edition ski trip announcement. So here's the deal. Ski trip is coming, and it's an early edition. We normally go with our student ministry on ski trip during spring break. But this year, we have this wonky circumstance where Tomball ISD and Klein ISD have different spring breaks. So instead of picking and choosing winners and losers, we said we're going to find a new way, and we are going on winter break ski trip. So have any of you ever gone through winter break, parents, and you got to Christmas and then you got to New Year's and you realized that you still had your kids in the house for another week? Not this year. This year, you're going to send them on ski trip, and they're going to have the time of their lives meeting with the Lord, building relationships with one another and with Jesus. And so we leave on January the 1st. I hope that you'll go ahead and sign up. Because it is so much earlier, these announcements are earlier, we are aiming to fill this trip in the next few weeks. So I hope that you'll go ahead and sign up. If you have any questions about ski trip, feel free to come ask me. I've been on every single one because I love it. And you could also just talk to our student ministry director, Jeremiah, and he would love to connect with you as well. Two more announcements. You might have noticed on your way in, this is Missions Month. As the campus of the Woodlands Methodist Church, you now have in your hands, you were given this on the way in, information about all of the mission ministries that we share in at the Woodlands Methodist. And so the theme of the missions ministry is until the whole world knows. And this is being lived out in such marvelous ways. 146 mission partners in 92 countries around the world, and we're so excited to be a part of that. I hope you take time to peruse this, to learn more about the ways in which we serve in mission together. But I also want to invite you to note the leaflet and the back of the one in the middle are different trips that are already planned, international mission trips that are already planned for 2025. I hope that you'll take a look at those, pray over that, and see if the Lord is inviting you to step forward in a new, fresh way and go on an international mission trip. It truly does have the opportunity to bless and enrich your lives. And then finally, I do want to share that we have the Way Men's Conference coming up. Last year, Pastor Zach and a small group of men from the church went to the Way Men's Conference, and we're so excited to go back this year as a part of the Woodlands Methodist and invite all of you men to come together to experience such an outpouring of the Spirit as men gather together to understand how the Lord is calling us forward to live faithfully as leaders in our communities and our homes. And so I hope that you would take time to go ahead and sign up for the Way Men's Conference. All the information is there on the QR code, and I look forward to seeing you there at the Way Men's Conference. This morning, we're going to take a moment to pray, to intercede, and just invite the Holy Spirit to gather with us. We're also going to take in this moment an opportunity to pray for one of the other campuses of the Woodlands Methodist, and that's this morning we're going to pray for Church at Montgomery. And so let's bow together for a word of prayer as the people of God. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for waking us up, filling our lungs with the breath of life yet again this morning, and the opportunity that represents, that we are able to yet again know what it is to meet with you and to serve you. Lord, we want to honor you with our lives this day. We want to honor you with our worship this day, that our prayer, that our song, that our hearts would be fully centered and devoted on you. Jesus, we love you, and we ask that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on the gathering of your people, Lord, that as we gather, that we would encounter you, that you would dwell in us, that you would anoint us with your presence so that we would know you so intimately, so purely, that you would bless us in that way, Lord. And we thank you for the ministry of the church at Montgomery, for the leadership there that gathers. Lord, we ask your blessing upon the church at Montgomery, Lord, that this morning, even now as they gather for worship, Lord, that you would pour out your Spirit, that you would be alive in their presence, and you would be known in miraculous ways. Lord, we pray for fruit in that community, that the community of Montgomery would be changed because of the ministry of the church at Montgomery. Lord, we thank you for this vision that you've given to that gathering of people to plant a body of believers on mission in Montgomery. Lord, I pray that you would bear fruit in your kingdom through their work. Be glorified this morning in all that we say and do. Meet with us now, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Well, church, wherever you are today, I just hope that you'll really take in the words of this next song, because there's a promise in there that says, fear and anxiety, it's not our future. God is our future. He is our future. So when you're ready, please stand and sing with me.
Let him turn it in your favor. Watch him work it for your good. He's not done with what he started. He's not done until it's good. Let him turn it in your favor. Watch it work it for your good. He's not done with what he started. He's not done until it's good. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello, love. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. It's a new horizon. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello, love. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. It's a new horizon.
And if you're ready for love, open up and just receive. Oh, 'cause what is pouring out is nothing you've ever seen. You've ever seen. Hello, peace. Hello, joy. Hello, Lord. Hello, strength. Hello, hope. It's a this out because we believe it. We declare it as truth. Let's sing this together, church. Fear is not my future. You are. Sickness is not my story. You are. Heartbreak is not my home. You are. Death is not the end, Jesus. You are. You are. Fear is not my future. You are. You are. This is not my story. You are. You are. is not my story. You are, heartbreak is not my home. You are, and death is not the end. You know that all those things are truth only through him. So we sing to our Jesus this morning.
Give me the one my soul delights.
Give me Jesus. You can have all this world, but give me Jesus. Just rest in his presence for a moment, church. Think of all the ways that he's good. Jesus, we make that our prayer this morning, that you would give us more of you, that you would fill us up with your presence. That you would make us more like you, that every moment of every day, every moment of our lives, we would fix our eyes on you. The more we get to know you, the more we want you. So God, make that true for us today, that we would desire you with pure hearts, that we would pursue you with pure hearts. Help us to come with open hands, open minds, and open hearts this morning as we hear your word. Let us leave changed. We thank you, Lord, for who you are. We pray all of this in your mighty and powerful name, the name that is Jesus. And all God's people together said, amen.
You may be seated. And at this time, the kids are dismissed to head back to Cove Kids with Miss Jen and Miss Amber Nicole to learn about Jesus and to grow in fellowship with one another. Church, let us never take this for granted to hear the hustle and bustle of all these kids heading back to Cove Kids. Amen. It's a good thing. So good. We are going to turn our attention to the book of Hebrews, and we're going to be in chapter 1. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to turn with me there, but first want to kind of set a new frame. We are transitioning. We have been in a series called Ecclesia, where we've been discussing and teaching on the names of the church, all of the names of the church, body of Christ, that we are a family. These are our names as the church. But now we're shifting our attention, and this series is called In Jesus' Names. And yes, that was plural. And it's because in the book of Hebrews, there are seven different names for Jesus, ways in which Jesus is referred to. And we're going to dig into that so we can understand more fully who Jesus is and what his word is in our lives. Before I read this text, I want to offer a warm greeting. We have the pleasure to have one of my friends and one of the great leaders I know of in the faith, particularly in the world of missions. The pastor, Ashley Goad, is here with us. And she's going to be bringing the word today. Would y'all give a warm welcome to Ashley Goad? Yeah. let's hear now from the Word of God in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Long ago, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. And now in these final days, he has spoken to us through his Son. God promised everything to the Son as an inheritance. And through the Son, he created the universe. The Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God. And he sustains everything by the mighty power of his command. When he had cleansed us from our sins, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Jason. Will you join me in prayer, please? Oh, good and gracious God, speak to us this morning. May your breath be in our lungs. May your word be in our mouths. May the meditations of our heart be pleasing to you, O God. Amen and amen.
Amen.
Well, good morning, Covenant Church. Oh, I'm so happy to be with you this morning. If we haven't met yet, which I think is most of us, like Jason said, my name is Ashley Goad, and I am your pastor of missions. And today is a special day for me. I'm calling today Mission Sunday, because for me, every day is Mission Day, so I think it should all be our Sunday as well. And every day, even if just for a brief moment, I love to sit back and to pause and to celebrate what God is doing around the world, and to reflect on how we as a church are part of that incredible movement. And let me tell you, being the pastor of missions is not something I take lightly. I treasure it deeply. I have the extraordinary privilege of connecting with our 146 ministry partners scattered across the globe. Think about that. 146 ministries, from the remote villages tucked away in Africa to the bustling neon-lit cities of Southeast Asia, from the places where poverty grips to areas bursting with untapped potential. God is on the move, and I get a front row seat for it. But enough about missions this morning. I could talk about that forever. Today, like Jason said, we are kicking off this new sermon series entitled In Jesus' Name. And over the next several weeks, we are exploring those seven names that we find in the book of Hebrews. And I'm going to list those for you. They're Son, Pioneer of Salvation, Apostle, High Priest, Forerunner, Mediator, and the Founder and Perfecter. Each of these names reveals deep truths to us about who Jesus is, and they tell us something about who we are too. And these names are more than just theological terms. They carry the power of identity and the power of purpose and the power of mission. We've all received the blessing of Christ and the great commission to do his and continue his work. He's the head of the body and the owner of all of these titles. And for us, that means that we're now called to be his mirror image by living into the same titles that the author of Hebrews gave to Christ. So I want us to start today with this first title, Jesus as Son. And this isn't just a theological title. It's a name that changes everything for us. So I'm going to read the scripture again. It's Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. That long ago, God spoke many times and in many ways to our ancestors through the prophets. And now, in these final days, he has spoken to us through his Son. God promised everything to the Son as an inheritance. And through the Son, he created the universe. The Son radiates God's own glory and expresses the very character of God, and he sustains everything by the mighty power of his command. When he had cleansed us from our sins, he sat down in the place of honor at the right hand of the majestic God in heaven. In these verses, the author of Hebrews makes an astounding statement. Jesus is not just another prophet or a teacher. He is the radiance of God's glory, the exact representation of his being. This means Jesus doesn't just reflect God like a mirror. He is God. He's God's glory shining through. So when we look at Jesus, we see the heart and the character and the very nature of God. So think about that for a moment. The very essence of who God is, his kindness, his justice, his mercy, his compassion, is made visible to us in Jesus Christ. This can change the way that we understand who God is and how we relate to him. No longer is he a distant God or an abstract God. In Jesus, God comes close, and we can see him clearly. One of my favorite stories in all of Scripture illustrates this beautifully. You probably know the story. It's Jesus healing the woman with the issue of blood. For 12 long years, she had suffered. She'd run out of doctors, money, even hope. Her friends had abandoned her, her church had neglected her, and she hadn't been home in years. But then one day, Jesus came to town. He was on his way to see the mayor's daughter who was dying. The crowd was thick and people were pushing, but she was desperate. She followed Jesus at a distance and gradually inched closer and closer to him until there were only a couple of people between him and her. And with bold courage, she pressed out her arm through the crowd and reached for the hem of his jacket, not to grab it, but just to touch. And when she did, her body changed. Her face filled with warmth, her back straightened. She could breathe deeply. She stopped, letting the crowd go by her. But then he stopped too. "Who touched me?" he asked. She hid behind some tall men because she didn't want to say anything. "But who touched me?" he asked again. He didn't sound angry, just curious. And so she spoke up. Her hands and her voice shook. And Jesus' response was like balm to her soul. He stepped toward her and asked to hear her whole story. And then he said, "Daughter, go. Your faith has healed you." Now imagine this, if you will. Everyone was waiting and waiting as Jesus listened. The crowd was waiting. The city leaders were waiting. A girl was dying. People were pressing. Disciples were questioning. But Jesus was listening. Listening to her whole story. He didn't have to do that. The healing would have been enough. Enough for her, enough for the crowd, but not enough for him. Jesus wanted to do more than heal her body. He wanted to hear her story, her whole story. What a kind thing to do. The miracle restored her health, but the kindness restored her dignity. And in the end, what did he call her? Daughter. He called her daughter. In that intimate, tender word, we see the radiance of God's kindness and love shining through Jesus. He sees her, he heals her, and he welcomes her back into relationship and community. It's in moments like this that we glimpse the radiance of God's mercy and compassion shining through the Son. Jesus reveals who God is, and through him, we see a God who is deeply invested into each one of us. This isn't a distant or an uncaring God, but one who stops for the suffering, one who notices the unnoticed, and one who heals the broken. Which brings us to a very critical question. If Jesus is the Son of God, and he perfectly reveals who God is, what does that mean for us? Well, here's the incredible part. Through Jesus, we're all invited into the same relationship with God. Galatians chapter 4, verse 6 tells us, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of God into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out, Abba, Father. Friends, this is more than a theological truth. This is a family story. You and I, through Jesus, are adopted into God's family. We get to call him Father. And as his children, he calls us son and daughter. And our lives are meant to reflect that same kindness, that same mercy, that same love that Jesus showed. So as we reflect on what it means to be sons and daughters of God, I want us to pause and consider the immense implications to this identity. To be a child of God isn't just about the personal assurance of salvation or eternal life. It's also a call to live out that identity in the world. As a child of God, we don't just reflect his name, we reflect his mission. Mission, I knew we would get back to that word. The world around us is crying out for the very same kindness and compassion that we have received through Christ. People are desperate for a glimpse of God's love, and we as his children have that privilege to be that glimpse. Whether it's in the way we care for our neighbors or how we respond to injustice or the way we serve those in need, we carry the name Son with us wherever we go. But here's where the rubber meets the road. Being a child of God does come with a mission. Jesus is the exact representation of God, and a foundational truth of the revelation of God in Jesus Christ is that he was sent. And this reveals something central about God's character. He is a God that goes. He goes to the lost, he goes to the needy, and he goes to the poor. So to mirror Jesus as those who are called children of God, just as Jesus is called the Son, is to be a people sent on mission for the world. Now, if I'm honest with you, I don't always want to leave the comforts of my couch or even the comforts of my everyday life. But my best friend and my favorite theologian, her name is Stefania, she lives in Romania, she often reminds me, Jesus didn't die on the cross for me to be comfortable. She's very convicting. Jesus sacrificed his life for us to be sent, to go into the world as ambassadors of Christ, reflecting his love and reflecting his truth and reflecting his grace to those who need it most. This title, Son, it's more than a title. It's our mission. And why, you may ask, why did God send his Son? Well, I think you already know the answer. You can say it with me if you would like. John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Yes, friends, God's mission was driven by love. Jesus didn't come just to preach a message, he came to live it. He didn't come to just build an earthly empire, he came to seek and save the lost. This is why I love thinking of Jesus as the ultimate missionary. He left his heavenly home, entered our broken world, and got to work amongst the people. And that's just what the author of Hebrews says. Jesus radiates God's glory and sustains everything by his powerful word. So not only does he reflect God's glory, but he's also actively involved in sustaining the world. Jesus isn't a passive figure. He's deeply engaged in the ongoing work of creation, of redemption, and restoration. Consider my friend Zach. Not that friend Zach, but maybe another guy named Zacchaeus. He was a tax collector. And here's a man who, by all accounts, didn't deserve Jesus' attention. He was a traitor to his people, collaborating with the Roman oppressors and getting rich off the people in his own community. But Jesus seeks him out. He stops. He looks up in that sycamore tree and says, "Zacchaeus, you come down." Anybody want to sing? "For I'm going to your house today, for I'm going to your house today." Friends, this was more than a PR move. Jesus wasn't trying to curry favor with the religious elite. He was on a mission. He was on a mission of reconciliation, a mission of transformation, a mission of love. And by the end, Zacchaeus' life was radically changed. He gave away half of his possessions to the poor and promised to pay back anyone he had cheated. That is the power of Jesus' mission, the power to transform lives. And that, my friends, is at the heart of God's mission through his Son to seek and to save the lost. Jesus' mission wasn't about staying within the comfortable walls of heaven or even of a synagogue or preaching from a distance. He entered people's homes. He sat with them at their tables. And through personal, intimate encounters, he brought about deep and lasting change. Our final verse today, Hebrews chapter 1, verse 3, it tells us that Jesus sustains all things by his powerful word. So not only did he create the world, but now he holds it together. And if the Son of God, who holds the universe in his hands, came to serve, well, what does that mean for us? Well, remember, it's more than just a title. It's our mission. Think about the last night of Jesus' life. He washed the disciples' feet. Here's the Son of God, the creator of the universe, kneeling on the floor, scrubbing dirty, grimy feet. He even washed the feet of Judas, the very one who would betray him later that night. This wasn't just an act of service. It was a radical love, an act of radical love and humility. In that moment, Jesus didn't just teach about service. He embodied it. He didn't serve to earn approval or to make a point. He served because that's who he is. God serves. And just as Jesus knelt to serve his disciples, we're called to take on that same humility and service in our lives. Now, maybe it wouldn't look like washing dirty, stinky feet, but it might look like showing up for a friend in need, giving time to someone who's hurting, supporting missions abroad, maybe going and working with Connect Steps or Team. There's something for everyone. Service is a reflection of the God who sustains us with his love. And as children of God, we don't just reflect his name. We reflect his mission. Friends, we live in a culture that values power and status and self-promotion. But the example that Jesus gives is so radically different. It's a model of servant leadership, of putting others before ourselves and seeking the good of those around us. I think about our missionaries and ministry partners that we support around the world. Did I mention there are 146 of them? These are men and women who have taken up the call to serve in some of the most challenging and overlooked places in our community and around our world. And they're not seeking fame nor fortune. They're seeking to reflect the heart of Christ by serving those in need. And in doing so, they embody this mission of Jesus, the Son of God who came not to be served, but to serve. And why does God serve? Well, I think it's because he's a generous God. One of the defining characteristics of Jesus' ministry was his generosity. Not just with material resources, but with his time and with his compassion, and ultimately with his life. Jesus, who is the heir of all things, didn't come to accumulate riches or power for himself, but he gave everything, including his own life. That is the ultimate expression of generosity. And it challenges us to consider how we can reflect that same spirit in our own lives. So when we think about missions and service and generosity, I think we often treat it as three separate boxes to check. But in Jesus, we see that they're all connected in the Son of God. Just as Jesus is the radiance of God's glory, when we live generously, we reflect that very nature of God. Remember the feeding of the 5,000? Jesus takes a boy's small lunch, 5 loaves, 2 fish, and feeds the entire crowd with leftovers to spare. That's what God's generosity looks like. Taking what seems small and insignificant, whatever we have to offer, and multiplying it into something abundant. And we're invited to live in that spirit of generosity. As we give, whether it's our resources, our love, and our time, and I do include time because I think time is one of the most precious and valuable gifts that we can offer to another. This is when we mirror the heart of the Father who so graciously and abundantly gives to us. Generosity isn't just about what we give. It's about how we give. And we're called to be generous, abundant, joyful givers. As children of God, we don't just reflect his name, we reflect his mission. So what does this all mean for us today? Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 3. Is it just a theological statement? I don't think so. I think for us, it's a missional charge. Jesus is the Son who reveals God, and we as his children are called to reflect that same nature in the world. It means that we are heirs, adopted into God's family through Jesus and sharing in his mission. It means we are sent. Just as God sent his Son, we're called to go out into the world and reflect that glory. It means we are servants. Just as God served, the Son served, we are called to serve those around us with kindness and humility. And friends, it means we're generous. We're called to reflect God's heart by giving joyfully, giving sacrificially, and giving abundantly. This title, Son, it's more than a title. It's our mission. And as we follow Jesus' example into the world, we mirror God's nature. And in doing so, we carry the very name of Jesus, Son and Daughter, with us wherever we go. Because remember, friends, it's more than a title. It's our mission. So let us go out today, not just on this Mission Sunday, but every day, because every day is Mission Day for me. Let's go out and be the hands and feet of Jesus, reflecting that glory of God through every facet of our lives. Will you pray with me? Oh Lord, we thank you for sending your Son, to reveal your heart to us. And so we ask that you help us to live as your reflections, reflections of your love, serving others and giving generously. God, may we carry your name of Son with us as we go out into this world, as we be a people of mission, because we know that it's more than a title, it's a mission. Amen. guests our Lord invites to the table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, friends, in silence, let us confess our sin before God. Died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You formed us in your image and breathed into us the breath of life. When we turned away and our love failed, your love remained steadfast. You delivered us from captivity and made covenant to be our sovereign God, and you spoke to us through the prophets. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. Your Spirit anointed him to preach good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed, and to announce that the time had come when you would save your people. Jesus healed the sick, fed the hungry, and ate with sinners. And by the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. When the Lord Jesus ascended, he promised to be with us always in the power of your word and your Holy Spirit. On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread and gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. And he turned to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, and again he gave thanks to you. And he turned to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood. It's the blood of the new covenant. It's poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we together proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. So now we ask, Almighty God, that you would pour out your Holy Spirit on these, your gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, both now and forevermore. Amen. Now let us join together as children of God, sons and daughters, praying the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Would those who are assisting come forward at this time? This morning we'll receive the sacrament of Holy Communion by means of intinction. There will be three stations, one for each section, where you will come with your hands held open under the direction of the ushers. You'll receive a piece of bread. You can then dip it in the cup and receive the sacrament in this way. There's also a fourth station here to your left of the altar that will be for either self-contained communion, where the bread and the cup are available in one container, or if you would like to receive gluten-free, that will be available in the fourth station. The ushers will direct you as we go. This is not Covenant's table. This isn't the Global Methodist Church's table. This is the table of our Lord Jesus Christ, and as such, each and every one are welcome to come. All has been prepared. Would you come at this time?
Desperate, reach the feet of the Savior. Nothing I wouldn't offer, there's no waste at the altar. With a heart of surrender, meets the hands of the Maker. broken dreams at the altar, and every victory at the altar. Fear and anxiety cannot live here. There's no ways at the altar. Let your heart sing out and tell him you love him. Don't make it perfect, just let it be honest. He can use anything, sit back and watch him. There's no waste at the altar. Come lay your broken dreams at the altar. And every victory at the altar. Fear and anxiety cannot live here. There's no waste at the altar. Let your heart sing out and tell him you love. Perfect, just let it be honest. He can use anything, sit back and watch him. There's no waste at the altar. No waste at the altar. There's no waste at the altar. There's no waste at the altar.
Lord, you are so good. Your steadfast love endures forever. Your presence is overwhelming. Your grace is more than enough. Your love, your faithfulness, your truth. We sit and dwell in your presence. And we are filled with joy to overflowing. And so, now receive this benediction, church. Sons and daughters, go be sent on mission in the world to carry God's love and grace to those we meet so that the world would know of your goodness, of your peace, all through the work of your church. So we go. We go in your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Peace be with you, brothers and sisters.